Well, good morning and welcome to God's house on this glorious Transfiguration Sunday. You've heard me say this is one of my favorite Sundays. This is one of my favorite Sundays. I just love this Sunday. And I heard so many good things about Pastor Bomer last week that you guys figured I should take a few more weeks off. And so I give God thanks and praise for Pastor Bomer and his service to you last week. And we thank God for all of you and for our visitors and guests who are with us. We will be receiving Holy Communion today. So all of you who are members in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod in good standing are welcome to come forward. If you are of a different denomination or would like a blessing, come forward, put your hands across your chest. And we will be doing continuous line today as it is the third Sunday of the month. And with that said, we're also going to be saying goodbye to the Alleluias. Kind of a tradition within our church and many church bodies that as you enter into the season of Lent, Ash Wednesday through until Easter morning, we do not sing the Alleluias. So we have a special Alleluia and verse that we'll be singing today. And our closing hymn will be praising God with our Alleluias as we enter into the Lenten season ahead of us. So we begin our service today as we open up our hymnals to hymn 836, O God of Light. Please stand as you are able. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, in the glorious transfiguration of your beloved Son, you confirm the mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. In the voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshadowed our adoption by grace. Mercifully make us co-heirs with the King in his glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And please be seated for our readings. Our Old Testament reading this morning comes to us from the book of Exodus, chapter 24. And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold, the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron and Nadab and Abihu and 70 of the elders of Israel went up, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, that I may give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandments, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses rose with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we return to you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute, let him go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord dwelt on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. And Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And our epistle today is from 2 Peter chapter 1. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased," we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven. For we were with him on the holy mountain. and we have something more sure, the prophetic word, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts, knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And as we say goodbye to our Alleluia, an excerpt from 1517.org, Valerie Thur puts it this way. Goodbye to the Alleluias. That is, we say, God be praised. There is no law mandating that we temporarily excommunicate Alleluias from our worship, but for those who choose to say a temporary goodbye to joyful praise, the focus is not so much on what we refrain from doing as it is on what we freely receive. So why would we bury our Alleluias during the season of Lent? Why don't we use the term that literally means praise Yahweh, the all-merciful covenant God who has claimed us as his own? We are travelers on this earth. Every misty road and agonizing moment of indecision reminds us that life is not about becoming or finding perfection. Life is the one who is perfect, the way we could never have discovered on our own. There is nothing that we can do or not do to change the way God loves us. We can reject his love, certainly. We can push him aside, spit on him, and remove him from our vocabulary. But our sin does not change who God is. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Not just those whose sin is severe enough to warrant public scrutiny. Each and every one of us killed God. Christ Jesus became my sin, your sin, in order to receive the wrath of God against every thought, word, and deed that stands in contrast to his perfection. Our word goodbye is a contradiction of the historical phrase, God be with you. And this is what we see on the cross. At the cross, God the Father said goodbye. He turned his face away from the Son, utterly forsaking him, so that our sins would die in agony and be buried forever. Immanuel, God with us, was slain so that the triune God could be with us, that the relationship between the Father and us could be restored. Lent is a time when the church, all individuals who have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, the world over, leans into the depth of God's love. While we were still sinners, unable to proclaim Jesus is Lord, Christ died for us, not because we were praising him, but so that we might know him as he is, not on our terms, but in his truth. We who were dead in our sins sing Alleluia, not in order to make ourselves alive, but because we have already been given life. Lent is a breathless, relentless focus on our complete inability to merit God's favor or earn even a sliver of his love. Our focus turns to the one who breathed into Adam the breath of life and ordains praise from the lips of his children. Those who do not sing Alleluia during the days leading up to Easter are motivated by love, not their love for Christ, but his love for them. In the same way, those who sing Alleluia are by no means less spiritual, less sincere, or less focused. In either case, the focus is not on the one who is or is not singing, but on the one who continues to rejoice over us with his never-ending song of salvation. Because of Christ, sinner saints proclaim that no farewell, no heartbreak, no parting can be compared with the glory that is coming to us through Christ Jesus. Because of the Holy Spirit who works faith in us, we cling not to earthly mirages of security, desperate to avoid all farewells, but to the empty cross and the empty tomb. Because of the Father's goodbye on Calvary, because of the glorious bodily resurrection of the slain lamb on the third day, whether we sing or do not sing, we can confidently proclaim that God is with us. Praise the Lord. Alleluia. So please stand as we sing our Alleluia in verse. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 17th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make 3 tents here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And a voice from the cloud said, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, rise and have no fear. And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. And at this time, I invite the children to come forward for the children's message. Good morning. Hey, I see a cast. What did you do? Wrestling. Okay. You know, we use our eyes, don't we, to see things. And sometimes, if I told you I caught a 35-inch walleye this past week, would you believe me or would you want to see a picture? Nora's going, I won't believe you. I need to see a picture. Grady goes, not a chance. You don't have an auger big enough to get a walleye through a hole. That is who we are, right? We like to see things. We like to see it. Like when you broke your arm, did you get to see the x-ray? Pretty cool, huh? Snap. No, I'm kidding, right? But we want to see these things. Well, this is what Jesus says at the end of our gospel text today. He says, tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. He's telling his disciples, Peter, James, and John, don't tell anybody what you guys just saw. How many of you guys, and I'm asking all the kids out in the pews too, how many of you are good at keeping secrets? Raise your hand. Yeah, that's what I thought. We're not very good at it. Summer, you're good at keeping secrets? Oh, that's good to know. Yeah, sometimes we hear something that or see something so spectacular, we've just got to tell people. Did you guys, anyone see the sunrise this morning? Spectacular. Anyone see my 35-inch walleye? Spectacular. But you don't believe me. Well, guess what? In our epistle reading, Peter listened finally. And it wasn't until after Jesus died, rose again, and ascended to heaven that he wrote this. He says, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory. This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. He was using two senses, wasn't he? He saw the glory of God, right? In the transfiguration of Jesus. And did he hear God? He heard God say, this is my beloved Son. Now for you and I, we get to go. We are so blessed that God enables us to go and share what we've heard today. So why don't we bow our heads and thank God for what we've heard. Dear God, thank you for shining your light, proclaiming your word, and leading us to share the good news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And all the kids said, rejoice. Head back to your seats and grab a treat, and the congregation will open up their hymnal to our hymn of the day, 414, 'Tis Good, Lord, to Be Here. Grace, peace, and mercy to you from God our Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So I get a sense that you don't believe my story. Interesting. But isn't it also interesting in our world today how the art of listening and seeing first has never been truly mastered by mankind? We get so caught up in thinking what we want to say next, or sharing perhaps what we want to see, than listening. Like Peter, we speak before we fully comprehend a situation many times in our lives. We allow our hearts and our emotions to drive our mouth and lose sight of our ears and our eyes, those beautiful members given to us by God. The disciples on this day were brought forth onto the mountaintop to see and to hear the glory of the Lord. Instead, Peter, speaking on behalf of James and John, misinterprets the situation, interrupts Jesus. And it's just 6 days earlier, and Matthew does a wonderful job of laying this out for us. It's 6 days earlier when Jesus makes that first specific announcement of his passion. This is a turning point in the ministry of Christ. And still the disciples would prevent this from taking place by opening their mouths and speaking of what they do not fully comprehend. You see, Peter speaks foolishly when he should be silent and listen and to see the glory of the Lord before him. Because Jesus is speaking with the law and the prophet. He's speaking with Moses and Elijah, who pointed to the coming of Christ. And here he is at the center as they are passing the baton, as it were, saying, he has come and here he is. But Peter interrupts to fill his own desires. I mean, who amongst us wouldn't want to tabernacle, spend time at the top of the mountain with Moses, Elijah, and most importantly, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents. And in the Greek, it's actually tabernacles, three tabernacles, that we may dwell and live in your glory all the days. But it loses sight of what Jesus spoke 6 days earlier, his passion prediction, that he would have to suffer and die, and 3 days later rise again. Peter's interruption shows how little he listened and understood the passion of Christ. But Peter's not alone. If you recall back in Matthew chapter 3, earlier last month, John tried to prevent Jesus' baptism. John, like Peter today, is not listening. Why listen when you have something to say? You ever been in that conversation with someone and they're talking and they're not listening? Have you ever been the one to be thinking about what you're going to say next while someone else is talking to you? Is it possible that you're sitting here today right now thinking about what's for dinner? What you got to get accomplished before the next big snowstorm? That is our human nature. We allow our minds to close down our eyes and our ears. We allow our minds to shut off what it is that God is showing us, declaring us in his glory. I mean, we need not look any further than the pierced hands and feet of Christ and his side to know that we have a living God. But we lose sight of that because we're too busy thinking about our own desires. How many of you older generations remember a company by the name of E.F. Hutton? They had a commercial when E.F. Hutton talks, and then the whole commercial goes silent. And then the tagline is, people listen. Why, oh, why do we not do that when God talks? People aren't listening. They're too busy thinking about what they want to do, what they want to say, what they want to see. Our sinful nature would rather speak before hearing and seeing the glory of God. Now, you want some examples. Have you ever watched the British Parliament? How they yell across the hall at one another? I have no idea how they ever accomplish any government. Or perhaps you've listened to congressional hearings. How they ever get anything accomplished is beyond me. Or how about political debates? You're not sure if an answer is actually given because of all the interruptions going on. And those are just a few things to name. Maybe you've noticed that in your very house or with your friends. Sometimes it's hard to get a word in edgewise because people aren't listening. But let me tell you, one of the greatest lessons I learned in my life about 15 years ago from a dear friend of mine, he said, listening is an art. Active listening is something that we must practice and ask God to help us with. Because all too often when people are conversing, they're too busy thinking about what they're going to say instead of what the person is saying who's speaking to them. I don't know about you, but I've had numerous times in my life when I've been having a conversation at the end, I thought, what did they just say? I was so busy. And so now I really do try to listen with intent. And if you feel like I'm staring at you, it's because I'm trying to block out everything else. I want to know what you have to say. And that is something that we can all continue to practice. But we must call upon God to lead us through this process. Because God lovingly silences Peter today in our text. While Peter is speaking, a shining cloud overshadows them and God speaks. So now we've got the visible, the shining cloud. And now we got the auditory, the words of God. This is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. It's great our God is consistent in his word. Because in Deuteronomy chapter 18, the Lord says, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen. We have been told throughout Holy Scripture of the coming of Christ, and when he comes, listen to him. And then God also says two key words here. This one, he's not pointing to Moses or Elijah. This one, my beloved son, this one is the key. He is God's one and only who has come to bring salvation to all who believe. Jesus speaks restoring words. Because like right now, some of you are probably thinking to yourselves, yeah, I think a lot of other things when people talk. But here's the restoring words of Christ to Peter and to James and John and you and me. Get up. Stop being afraid. Follow me. Follow our Lord. Listen to him. Jesus speaks a restoring word to those who listen. We are left with one thought, one reminder today and every day. Listen to him. For Christ crucified is for all. No need to look elsewhere. For we have the word of Jesus. We have the living word, the word of salvation. We have the word of eternal life in Christ Jesus. Listen to him. Through holy baptism, God grants us the gift of listening to his son. Because this is not a work of our own. To be active listeners of our Lord and Savior, is to be led by God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit. So when we listen, God reminds us we are forgiven, we are redeemed, and we are sanctified through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. Isn't it interesting? All we're called to do is listen. We have two ears, but we struggle to use them. Therefore, each week, it is my responsibility, it is my joy to share a message that should remind and please each person that you are a child of God. And all he's done is call you to listen. God knows our weaknesses, our short-term memory, and our need to be reminded that we are his children, co-heirs with Christ. He calls us each day to listen to his beloved Son, in whom he is well pleased. In Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds with Christ Jesus. Amen. At this time, please stand as we confess our common faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds with the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And at this time, as our offering is brought forward, we lift up in our prayers our dear sister in Christ, Millie Bieber, who is in hospice. We continue to pray for comfort and the assurance of the resurrection. We continue to thank God for Linda Wagner and her recovery from surgery on her broken wrist. And of course, with Maddox as well. And then a dear friend of ours from our home church, Kim Peisler, who they found a large growth on her brain and will be doing a biopsy on Monday. So we want to lift up Kim and her family in our prayers as well. So let us take our tithes and offerings and our prayers to the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you revealed your glory in the transfiguration of your Son, who tabernacled among us in the flesh. Open our eyes that by faith we would see him continuing to tabernacle among us in the divine service. Grant that we would heed your admonition to listen to him as he forgives and preserves us at the font, pulpit, and altar. Holy God, we ask for your blessing on this congregation, especially for our catechumens. As Moses was changed when he saw your glory on Mount Sinai, may we who have beheld your glory in the face of Christ also be transformed and given boldness of spirit to share your glory abroad. God of all comfort, you alone bring the peace that passes understanding to troubled hearts. Remember the afflicted and those who have passed. Lord, we are with Larry and Joyce Miller on the passing of Joyce's father, Andrew Molitor. Continue to bring them peace and comfort and rest and assurance of the resurrection, that they would know your presence, taste your peace, and receive healing according to your gracious will, ever trusting in the hope of the resurrection. Lord, we praise you, for we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Give us ears to hear your voice speaking through your word, holy lips to receive Christ's blessed sacrament with repentance and faith, and holy awe at your glory granted to us in the means of grace. Lord God, your power is beyond compare and your glory beyond understanding. Open our hearts to know you through the glory of your Son, whose saving will and purpose has rescued us from sin and death, made us your own people by baptism and faith. For to you, blessed and eternal Father, belong all honor and glory, worship and praise, with your beloved Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we continue as we sing our offertory on page 159.
What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits to me? I will offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving and will call on the name of the Lord. I will take the cup of salvation and will call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord now in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem.
And we continue with the service of the sacrament.
The Lord is with his people now, may he be with you. Thankful hearts now raise him.
It is truly right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places, we should offer thanks and praise to you, Heavenly Father. For you sent your only begotten Son to those who dwelt in darkness, that in the face of Jesus Christ all people might behold the fullness of your glory. Enlightened by his presence, we join the praises offered by your faithful people always and everywhere.
Hosannas glad and glorious.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Taught by our Lord and Savior and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray.
Most holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth in heaven the same. Give us this day the food we need, forgiven may we be. Into temptation to from evil set us free. All rule and might and glory be to you while ages run, and even to eternity. Amen, so be it done.
When we eat this bread, we share the body of Christ. When we drink this cup, we share the blood of Christ. Reveal yourself to us, O Lord, in the breaking of bread, as once you revealed yourself to your disciples.
Lamb of God, almighty Savior,
The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. And we continue as we stand and sing the Thanksgiving as printed.
Let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My eyes have seen the light increase, which for the world you will. For Israel's light, the promised one, now shines for all to see. To God the Father, Spirit, Son, be praise eternally.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you, and in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The good Lord bless and keep you. Lift up his shining face, with favor look upon you, and grant eternal peace. God, Father, Son, and Spirit, most gracious one in three, be praised throughout creation and to eternity.
And please be seated as we sing our closing hymn, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.
Thank you.
As some of you may have recognized, there were some things going on in the back here this morning. We were blessed to have visitors, and one of our visitors, her name is Lily, a good friend of Drake Grind, had a seizure and has been taken away. So at this time, please stand and join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning just so thankful for the blessings you bestow upon us. And Lord God, we are thankful that you have put men and women in Lily's life here this morning to help her and to take care of her as she's gone to the hospital. We ask your prayers and your hand of healing upon her. Be with the medical staff tending to her and bring her back to us here at Immanuel Lutheran Church in good health, that she may continue to hear about the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, our Redeemer. In his name we pray. Amen. And please be seated for a quick moment. I won't go through all the information that's in here, but Amy's put a lot of great information in here. I please ask you to take a look at the bulletin, take it home with you. I actually brought something up with me that has been printed and Amy's putting in back. It is titled The Man of Sorrows, People of Joy. It's the Lenten devotions for 2023. Lent starts Wednesday, so please grab one out of the back. She's got both large print and the regular print, which I'm holding here. If we run out, let us know, and we'll make more copies, and we'll get them to you before Wednesday. And speaking of Wednesday, we've got three services this year for a variety of reasons, but it's all to the glory of God. And so if you're a morning person, we will be having a morning Ash Wednesday service here with the Immanuel Lutheran School students at 8:20. But because our early out is so much earlier this year, we're still having a noon service. But to get the kids out of here sooner, they're not going to be participating in that midday service. And is it noon or 1? Do you recall? 1 o'clock, sorry. So if you come at noon, you can hang out with me for an hour. But come at 1 o'clock. We are receiving the imposition of ashes again this year. And so please join us for that. It's a wonderful symbol of that darkness of our sin, but yet that cross that is put upon our forehead is a great reminder of how our sin has been covered over by the blood of Christ and what he's accomplished as our crucified Lord and Savior. So that'll be 1 o'clock on Wednesday, and then again at 7 o'clock for all of those who are able to join us. We will have a 7 o'clock service as well. So please join us for one of those three services. This is a wonderful time of the year as we enter into this penitential season to thank God for all of his work, all of his love for you. And then I noticed there's a few signups in the back. We've got signup sheets for Oktoberfest. We need your volunteerism. Things cannot get done without you, so please sign up. There's also signups for other things back there. I know we've even got the thermometer for the brand new organ that we're looking at bringing in. You guys have been wonderful. We're about a third of the way there in our giving for the organ, which means we still need 2/3 more. So we thank all of you for continuing to prayerfully consider supporting the new organ that our church desperately needs. And there will be Lenten suppers. I believe they will be beginning February 22nd through the 29th of March. So join us for those meals. It's a great time for fellowship and then to come up and continue to be fed the word of God. And we are back in Bible study today in the book of Ruth, chapter 2. It is a great book. I invite all of you to come and join us for that downstairs. I also saw there were some wonderful treats that were brought in, and I want to thank all of you who continue to work tirelessly on behalf of the Lord in serving your brothers and sisters in Christ. And so thank you to all of you for your service. So with that said, why don't you greet your neighbor in peace, and I'll greet you in the back.